Those who've joined us on live stream as well. When kindred spirits get together, there's an environment that's created that is can't be duplicated anywhere else.
Yeah, amen.
And when Jesus says there's where two or more are gathered, there am I in the midst of them, that's a whole lot different than with one person. And in fact, I don't think anyone is able to calculate what the effect of a group of people together with one heart and one soul. I don't think we're able to calculate the potential of that kind of a gathering. But I like to think about it. Tonight we're going to read of the cover the dedication of Jesus. I might suppose, what would Jesus have to be dedicated for? Well, he was dedicated.
Yes.
Because God said to do it.
That's right.
It'll be in Luke, 2nd chapter, verses 21 through 39. Luke 2, 21 through 39. And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. The same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. I want to keep in mind, this is the Holy Spirit moved him to say this. This is how the Holy Spirit talks. A light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through thy own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. That is, let me read that without that parenthetical statement. You shall be for us, many in Israel, for a sign which shall be spoken against, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, a daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with a husband even 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she coming in that instant gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee to their own city, Nazareth.
Amen.
And we're going to be exposed to the fulfilling some requirements that were of the law, and I want to say a word about the ministry of the law here. The law tutored people for obedience. I don't know whether you thought about it that way before or not, but it taught people what it meant to obey God. It taught people what to do, how to do it, when to do it, where to do it. What was that all about? It was teaching people to obey. It was confirming that men have to be instructed on what to do when it comes to serving God. The basic nature of man was corrupted, so that man was fundamentally on his own. He was fundamentally self-centered. And anyone, consequently, that demanded his allegiance, it kicked against that, naturally. And aside from that, they were incapable of distinguishing good and evil. I couldn't tell. Since Adam and Eve, mankind lost the ability to distinguish good and evil when they committed the sin. And until they live with Christ for a while, and by reason of use, they're not able to do it. You can't define good and evil just by textual statements. It's not that simple. Some things you can, yes, but it's not that simple. I'm telling you why God instituted the law. And what we're seeing is Joseph and Mary, they learned. They learned how to obey. God said to do something, they did it. Before the law, people didn't know what to do. Abraham would have never went to Canaan if God didn't tell him to go there. He'd have lived and died in Ur of the Chaldees. See, man didn't know. Man couldn't figure out like the will of God. The only way they knew it, God had to tell them. The only way they really knew what to do is God had to tell them. Then they had some experience they could pick up, on some things, I understand. If they'd not been told Sarah was going to have a son, they'd have never, the thought of that never entered their mind. And Abraham would never have volunteered to offer Isaac. He had to be told. Because a moral wall had been raised between man and God. In Christ, this is not the way it is, but it's amazing how many people think it's still this way. Some people think it's still this way, but it's not still this way. After the law is enforced, of course, people were told to do certain things at certain times in certain places. And if you're familiar with the law, you know how particular it was. The history of God's exclusive dealings with Israel, which was 1,500 years, confirms that men do not by nature, they can't be consistently directed by a word. I mean, this is God that said it. They still disobeyed it. They're big. It's just God Almighty that parted the Red Sea. That God. Drowned all Pharaoh's armies. That God. But man's contrary to God by nature. His nature's at variance with the divine nature. Even with nice people. There's some nice people that they're not abrasive or anything, but before God they are. In the case of Joseph and Mary, we're going to find that everything wasn't crystal clear. Let's face it, Gabriel, an angel, talked to both Joseph and Mary. And they still... We're going to read something tonight. They were stymied by it. They didn't understand it. And even later, when Jesus was 12 years old, he still had trouble understanding. And these were the best people of the human race.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, pick up on things like this, because it's going to teach you why there has to be a new birth.
Amen.
Now, in our text, we'll be introduced to two more godly people. Thus far, we've been introduced to Joseph and Mary and Elizabeth and Zacharias and the shepherds and now Simeon and Anna. All of these people were holy people. Nothing was said like to Herod. No word was delivered to the Pharisees or Sadducees or the high priest, Caiaphas. These were all holy people. You got to really pick up on this, because this is still how God is. If you got a congregation of unholy people, God's not going to talk to that congregation. People got to see this. That's why they have to have all this innovation and all this. That's why. I know there's some that everybody sitting there is not ungodly. I'm not saying they are, but I'm saying there's not many of them. That's what I'm saying. The entrance of the Word of God, the Word made flesh. The entrance of the Word made flesh into the world will not be attended by insensitive people. God will not allow this to happen. Why? Well, go ahead, brother.
Even in this time what we're reading about, God didn't choose one of the Pharisees to do this. These were these two holy people that were in the temple, and it's like they were out of place in the temple at the time.
Right. Now, this is when Jesus came into the world, so this would be, you might think, the least qualifications. Well, no, the qualifications are standard.
Amen.
You want to hear from God? You want God to bless your life? Is that what you want? You have got to be holy.
Yes. Amen.
This is a requirement. You've got to stand out from all other people, except other holy people. We'll find throughout the gospel that a conscious involvement of God is always confined to holy and dedicated people. They're the ones that got to know what's going on. Unbelieving, indolent people are always limited. Always. And I think this is a divine manner. Now, it's important to note this because of the state of the modern church. I know some people don't like us to bring this up, but this is where we're living, brethren. We got to bring it up.
That's right. Amen.
Because this condition contradicts everything God says about salvation. Why is it this way? It's because it's an environment God doesn't work in. That's why it's that way. I mean, you can give these people study courses and workshops and all kind of stuff, and it won't do the trick. It won't turn the tide. It's because this is not the kind of environment God works in. Even like before Christ, you take holy men like Moses and the prophets, and some of those would leave a whole lifetime and maybe have one or two confrontations of God. It wasn't like every day. And that's with the best of the human race. So this explains to me, this explains why this condition exists. We need to stop trying to diagnose it, you know, and all this. Why does this happen? It's somebody's trying to eat from two tables. And the Lord has said you can't. Not law can't. Possibility can't.
That's right.
You cannot eat from the table of the Lord and the table of devils.
Amen.
So when you start eating at the devil's table, everything's taken off the Lord's table.
That's, right.
That's the way it is.
Amen.
I wish that more people knew that. Now let's get into our text. When the 8 days were accomplished for the circumcision of the child, eight days, see, that was established in covenant to Moses, and then it was inculcated into the law also. that a man child was born, he had to be circumcised on day 8. If you were sick on day 7, it still had to be day 8. I'll read the law to you. If a woman have conceived seed and born a man child, then she shall be unclean 7 days. According to the days of the separation of her infirmity, shall she be unclean, and in the 8th day, the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. I see a lot of Israelites forgot that.
Yeah.
Joseph and Mary didn't. They didn't forget it.
Yeah.
This covenant was originated with Abraham in Genesis 17:12. When Israel came out of Egypt, a great triumphal exit, all of the males at the time they exited were circumcised. Not at the time, they were circumcised when they came out. None of them were uncircumcised. However, when they got to Canaan, here's what it says. And Joshua made him sharp knives and circumcised the children of Israel at the heel of the foreskins. And this is the cause why Joshua did circumcise. All the people that came out of Egypt that were males, even all the men of war, died in the wilderness, by the way, after they came out of Egypt. Mm-hmm. Now, all the people that came out were circumcised.
Yeah.
But all the people that were born in the wilderness, by the way, they came out forth out of Egypt, whom they had not circumcised. Mm-hmm. See, it's still technical. Even though this walking in the wilderness is a punishment, you'd think it'd make people a little more keen, you know. Nobody that was born after they got out of Egypt was circumcised for 40 years. So he just had one grand circumcision service. Now, in other words, Joshua 5:3-7, let me read further. For the children of Israel walked.
Yeah.
They walked.
Yeah, right.
Walked 40 years in the wilderness, till all the people that were men of war, which came out of Egypt, were consumed, because they obeyed not the voice of the Lord, unto whom the Lord sware that he would not show them the land which the Lord sware unto their fathers, that he would give them, a land flowing with milk and honey, and their children whom he raised up in their stead, them Joshua circumcised, for they were not circumcised because they had not circumcised them by the way. Now, the law wasn't obviated during those 40 years. Now, Jesus is born, and hundreds of years have passed since this. They didn't forget Zacharias and Elizabeth. See, they didn't forget. See, because times are bad doesn't mean it's right to forget. Nobody can be sloppy and say, I am, because it's not right over there. It's because the Christian people aren't right. That's no reason. That's no reason. During the great falling away of Israel, these couple, they kept the law.
Yeah.
And he knows they didn't forget. Now, it'd been 9 months. Well, about 10 months now. Most of them have been 10 months. Since Gabriel said his name would be called Jesus. Now, a lot of folk can forget a lot of stuff for 10 months. They didn't forget. They named him. They didn't forget that name.
Amen.
In fact, here's how the scripture reads in Matthew 1. Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which she has conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. Then it says, and he knew her not till she brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. See, these are the kind of people now we're dealing with. It makes sense, doesn't it? If the word made flesh enters into the world, it should be surrounded by obedience and holiness and things like this. And when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem. Now, the law of Moses stipulated how long she was unclean, how long it took to purify her. That's outward purification, so she'd be fit to come back into the camp. Here's what it said, Leviticus 12:2, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a woman have conceived seed and born a man-child, then she shall be unclean 7 days, according to the days of the separation of her for her infirmity, that shall she be unclean. And the eighth day, the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised, and she shall then continue in the blood of her purifying 33 days. She shall touch no hallowed thing, nor come into the sanctuary until the days of her purifying be fulfilled. They've been fulfilled.
Yeah.
7 plus 33.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
40.
Yeah.
Okay, some people think they brought Jesus to the temple when he was 8 days old. No. Mm-hmm. He is 40 days old. Mm-hmm. That was the law.
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't get out of the camp. 40 days had been set. And they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And I will go back, I'm going to follow the law. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two pigeons. Now, when they brought under the law, they brought it, the child, to the door of the tabernacle and to the priest. See, but not to the temple. Temple took the place of the tabernacle. And so they bring it there, and they're going to offer the least sacrifice that was allowable. You were supposed to offer a lamb, but said if they don't have a lamb, they could offer two turtle doves.
Mm-hmm.
So we know from this they were poor, see? We don't have to guess at this. They were poor. Poor people sometimes don't give to the Lord because they're poor.
Mm-hmm.
That Lord doesn't receive that. That Lord doesn't receive that.
Amen.
I want to make so much I can't give to the Lord. The Lord doesn't receive that. You give according to what you have, not what you have not.
Amen.
So you give an equivalent of two, like two turtle doves. There's a minimum.
Mm-hmm.
You give it. Now, if there's any question about the defiling effects of sin, you would think that if ever a person wouldn't be really defiled, it'd be when at giving birth. That would be, you'd think that would be a time that you would not noted for impurity. See? But lo and behold, there was impurity at the time of birth. So that's telling you, see, the defiling effects of sin.
Yes, amen.
It's not defiling like sin defiling.
Uh-huh.
He's teaching you.
Yeah.
Sinners bring more defilement when they produce children.
Mm. Yeah.
Hmm? Mm. Now people couldn't receive that, see? They think a little child, no, that little child has a stone in her heart.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
First chance they have to lie, that's what they'll do.
Mm-hmm.
You got to teach them. See, you got to teach them because of that.
That's right.
But
Amen.
You learn this from this text. This purification mm-hmm. teaches you about how sin had permeated the race. All right, they're at the temple now. Now, who's God going to employ now? As it say, whoever's high priest at that time. That's not how it works. See, this is the birth of the Lord. So.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a man there. He's not the high priest. Man named in Jerusalem, where they were at. There was a man where they were at in Jerusalem named Simeon. And he was a devout man. He was just and devout. All right, he qualifies. We've got involved in conception and birth. We got Mary, Elizabeth, Zacharias. You have John in the prenatal. John the Baptist, got Joseph, John the Baptist, the shepherds, those the shepherds testified to. See, so far we got These are the caliber people we got. And just to show you further, we've got Gabriel and the angels of the Lord and a multitude of heavenly hosts. So that is, now these are.
Amen.
Won't you see, brethren, that when we gather together, what we want to seek to do, have?
Yeah.
You want to seek to have as much, as many personalities from heaven as is possible with us.
Amen.
Make sure we're all suitable vessels.
Yes.
And if a person isn't, they said they could write, settle it.
That's right. Amen.
Then settle that condition right now. Just settle it.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Because we want God to work when he's with us.
Amen.
But there's an absence of uncommitted people. And nobody from the Sanhedrin who said is there. No representative of the Sadducees, the Pharisees are not there. Only people of faith.
Yes.
Now, there's something to be learned from this. The more ungodly people there are in the vicinity of divine working, the less is revealed. Now you'll have to go through the Gospels and you'll find this is an inviolable rule. This happens consistently wherever Jesus was. The more ungodly people they are, the less that is revealed. That's why Jesus spoke in parables to the multitudes. That's why he did. You can see the, I call it a fatal flaw, of the practice of filling up the congregation with sinners, thinking that will convert them. What actually filling it up with sinners neutralizes what God can do.
Amen.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh boy, I wish more people saw that. Paul represented a hypothetical situation to the Corinthians. He said, now, if he didn't say it, make sure there's a lot of strangers and unbelievers in the assembly. Everybody bring in at least 3 strangers and 5 unbelievers. They didn't do stuff like that back in the early days. They gathered together to get away from those kind of people. So that when they went out among them again, they'd be strong and able to withstand. See? It was a different situation. He said, man comes into the assembly, stranger, an unbeliever. Everybody prophesies, edifying one another, comforting one another. Now, the people that, they don't know about this stranger. But God knows about it. So he's using it. He's these members of the body. So he's working through the members of the body. And they're saying things. Whoa, it's convicting this, this man.
That's right.
Finally, he falls on his face. He says, whoa, he says, God's in you of a truth. See, revealed his heart. The thoughts of his heart were revealed.
Uh-huh.
That's what should happen.
Yes.
When a stranger comes among the God's people.
Amen.
There should be a conviction.
Amen.
It registers on him.
Yes.
This kind of people have always existed. Mm-hmm. But a remnant was, it was Abel. It was Enoch. It was Noah. There were some believers in Malachi's day. See, but there's always been this kind of person, somebody like this, has been around all through history. David wrote, know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. So whoever they are, set apart. What for? So he can use them. Mm-hmm. Here was a godly man. God has set him apart. He's going to use him now. Mm-hmm. And it said he's waiting for the consolation of Israel. Mm-hmm. Other versions say looking for the consolation, looking forward to it, waiting for the comfort of Israel. The word translated consolation means a calling near. It is the idea is it's a close up comfort and ministry. It's a close up. Face to face, so to speak, versus shouting across the sea, you know. Now, this is the only place in Scripture, in any standard version of the Scripture, where the expression consolation of Israel is mentioned. You'd think you'd find that. You'd think you'd find that in the prophets, but it's not in there. In fact, the word consolation in the English version is only found one time in from Genesis to Malachi. It's only found one time. As in the King James Version, Jeremiah 16:7. It's found 2 times the word consolation. found two times the American Standard Version, three times the New King James Version. It's found four times the New American Standard Version, three times in the NIV, five times in the New Revised Standard Version, and five times in the Revised Standard Version. See, so this is not like, was not like a common word.
Yeah.
And none of those verses that I cited to you were messianic.
Uh-huh.
None of them were messianic. Uh-huh. Isaiah did say that the Messiah would comfort all that mourn. That's he kind of come close.
Mm-hmm.
I'm drawing, building to a conclusion here.
Mm-hmm.
All the text is, that text itself isn't crystal clear that it was the Messiah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Jesus is the one that drew out that it was speaking about him.
Mm-hmm.
God did promise his people, as one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you. See,
mm-hmm.
he did.
Yeah.
He told people that. In prophesying of John the Baptist, in that prophecy, God said that he should say, comfort ye my people, saith the Lord, speak ye comfortable to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, her iniquity is pardoned, she has received double for her sins. And then the next verse is the voice of him crying in the wilderness about John the Baptist. So what I'm saying is that this thing, he's the consolation of Israel, was a conclusion. It was an inspired conclusion that Simeon reached, because the scripture didn't verbatim say that, but it did by insinuation, it did say that, see? So he was able to pick up that this comfort was going to come from a person. It wasn't going to be like a mass comfort distributed like the manna was. It wasn't that... going to come to a person, but I just, that's what happens when a person lives close to God. You can draw some valid conclusions.
Amen.
You better make sure they're valid. I understand that, but that's what we have here. So during the time of Malachi, a holy remnant existed.
Mm-hmm.
There was a time when it was so bad. Here's how Isaiah described it. He said, judgment is turned away backward. He's speaking of a generation. Judgment is turned away backward, and justice standeth afar off. The truth is fallen in the street, and equity cannot enter.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, truth faileth, and he that departeth from evil maketh himself a prey.
Yeah.
And... The Lord saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no transgressor. And it says that the condition he saw, quote, displeased him that there was no judgment. See, so
Amen.
You probably have noted how more and more there's a lack of judgment.
Yeah.
God's noted it too.
Amen.
This is very displeasing to God. You don't want God displeased.
No.
Remember that there, God just was going to punish Jerusalem. And before he did, he showed this in a vision to Ezekiel. And he sent an angel, said, put a mark on everyone that's sighing and crying because of the abominations in Jerusalem. Put a mark on them.
Yeah.
And report back here when you're done.
Mm-hmm.
When the destruction begins, don't touch those people. So we got people that are warning us about some kind of, invasion and collapse and all this. And I don't question that. But I want the mark.
Yeah, amen. Yes.
You want the mark too.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
That's no guarantee that we understand that you positively will never experience harm, but it will not be anything that separates you.
Yes.
Or that you can't hold up under.
Amen.
And remember how Jesus felt when he looked at Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Anyone else would look at it and say, boy, that's a very religious city. That's a very religious city. The most prominent building in the city is the temple. Look at there.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And look at all the religious groups there are.
Mm.
got the priests and the chief priests and the high priest and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Sanhedrin. You just look there, how we're filled with activity, feasts going on. See, you can only imagine how it looked. Mm-hmm. But when Jesus looked at the city, that's not what he saw.
That's
not what he saw. Mm-hmm. We are to understand it was a time of relative peace. There had been an insurrection that Barabbas was involved in, we don't understand. But here's what he said. First, he says he wept.
Yeah.
Now, it takes a little bit to move the Lord Jesus to weep.
Uh-huh.
In fact, he'd tell some people, don't weep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He wept. If thou hast known, even now, at least in this thy day, the thing, that is, maybe you've been ignorant up to when I got here, but during this time, the thing that belonged to you under thy peace, but now they're hid from thine eyes. See, across the line.
Yeah.
There's no coming back. Hmm. For the days shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee, compass thee on every side, keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave thee one stone upon another because you didn't know when you were visited.
Yeah. Amen.
I want to know when the Lord's visited me.
Yeah.
I don't want to be obtuse about that. But you've got to keep your wits, spiritual wits, and focus to be in that condition.
Yeah.
See, when Israel was in a decayed condition, it agitated Jesus.
Yeah.
Not a red in the face agitation, a weep, and have to announce, this is it. I'm not giving you another chance.
Yeah.
That's what he was telling them. So there are occasions when special insights needed. I'm beginning to think we're in an occasion like that when what you see has to affect you the right way. See, a lot of people know things aren't ideal. I mean, a lot of people know that. A lot of people know that there's trouble. A lot of people know that, but it doesn't affect. They're still worldly people. They're not running to fleeing for refuge to Christ. See, if you see this, you got to get to Jesus.
Yeah.
Flee to him for refuge to lay hold on the hope set before you. Anyway, there was our introductions to Simeon. Says the Holy Spirit was upon him. Some versions say the Holy Spirit was with him. The Holy Spirit was in him. He was filled with the Holy Spirit. He's under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit came to him under the influence of the Holy Spirit. His heart was open to the Holy Spirit. I just like he was on him. I don't know why they had such trouble. Came down from heaven on him. The Spirit came down from heaven and rested on Jesus.
Yeah,
see,
that's
the type of thing we're talking about. And it was revealed to him by the Holy Spirit, that came down on him. Which means when the Holy Spirit comes down, it's personal.
Yeah.
It was revealed unto him. There are people to whom things are made known.
Yes.
But they don't understand them. Like Pharaoh of Joseph's time.
Yeah.
Something was revealed to him. The butler. Pharaoh's butler. Something was revealed to him. He didn't know what it was. See, the baker.
Yeah.
Something was revealed to him. He didn't know. Pharaoh himself had these dreams. He had no idea what they meant. Nebuchadnezzar.
Yeah.
One of the great revelations of Scripture was revealed to him. He couldn't even remember what he dreamed. So you see, there are cases where things revealed. But that wasn't the way it was with Simeon. The Holy Spirit does not need to be instructed, when he comes. other people had to be told what to do. When Jesus became a man, he was told what to do. As he was in flesh, he was told what to do. But the Holy Spirit, he knows the deep things of God. Yeah. See, he doesn't have to be instructed. God reveals, and that's the Holy Spirit that reveals to us the deep, deep things of God.
Yeah.
How does he reveal them? You're able to see them and comprehend them and make an association with them, how you should react to them. Mm-hmm. Now, the Holy Spirit revealed to him that he should not see death. Now, remember, Hezekiah was told, set your house in order, you're going to die. Mm-hmm. See? Mm-hmm. Pasher, he was told where he was going to die. And Jeremiah told Hananiah was going to die that year. And Zedekiah was told he'd die in peace. But Simeon is told you're not going to die until... See, it's... My times are in his hands.
Amen.
See, that's an example of it. You're not going to die until you've seen the Lord's Christ. Mm-hmm. Now, see, that phrase is not in the prophets.
Uh-huh.
You had to have some kind of understanding.
Yeah.
They had an idea of the Messiah or the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the Lord's
Christ.
Amen. The most prominent association Jesus has is with God the Father.
Yeah,
that's got to register with people.
Uh-huh.
And even to put your mind around that and be able to embrace it, you've got to forget yourself just to do that.
Yes.
That's on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
His primary authority, if you try and have God conduct himself like Christ's primary association is to you or to the human race, you are off on the wrong foot to begin with.
That's right. Yeah.
That's not the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
He's the Lord's Christ. Notice how these statements in Scripture, verse Acts 4:26, the early church knew this. The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. Revelation 11:15, the seventh angel sounded, there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of the world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and his Christ. Revelation 12:10, I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Luke 9:20, he said unto them, but thou whom say ye that I am? And Peter answered and said, the Christ of God. See, so it's the Lord's Christ.
Yeah.
I want to take a moment here to mention the association that Jesus has to God. I want to show that. I've listed all these scriptures down here. I'm just going to mention these. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of the living God. He's the Christ of God. He's the chosen of God, the Lamb of God, the express image of God, the bread of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God, the image of God. See, so... He's on the right hand of God. The Father sent the Son. The Son came to do the will of the Father. The Son only spoke what the Father told him to speak. The Son only did what he saw the Father doing. The Father draws people to Christ. The Son brings the people to God. God delivered up Jesus. God raised up Jesus. God glorified Jesus. Jesus offered himself to God. Jesus will confess the saved before the Father. The saved are the children of God. God has delivered all things to the hands of the Son. The cup Jesus drank was given to him by the Father. God commanded Jesus to lay down his life, take it up again. Jesus could do nothing of himself, but spoke as his Father taught him. The Father honored the Son. The Son honored the Father. The Father loves the Son. The good works showed to men were from the Father. Jesus did the works of his Father. Men do greater works because Jesus went to the Father. Jesus is the true vine. His Father is the husbandman. Jesus makes known all things he heard from the Father. Jesus reconciles us to God. God causes us to triumph through Christ. Glory is brought to God and the church by the primary association with them. I mean, it's there it is. It's quite plain. The fundamental reason for Christ is God.
Amen.
God's will, God's purpose, God's love. Take God out of the equation, and there is no reason for Christ.
Yeah.
Now that puts man in his place.
Yeah, that's right.
That puts man in his place. Mm-hmm. My persuasion that this is not how Jesus is ordinarily presented to our generation. He's commonly seen as the answer to temporal problems and challenges of everyday life and the means of becoming happy and so forth. And that vista is just too small. The state of lostness. What is the state of lostness? Is it that you committed X number of sins? Is that lostness is being alienated from the life of God.
Amen.
Lostness is being enemies of God. Lostness is being subject to the wrath of God. See, I'm showing you that Jesus, his connection with God, that's the connection. You can't be associated with Jesus without becoming associated with God and God becoming associated with you. But you can't be associated with God or God with you if Jesus isn't in the thing. The Holy Spirit will not direct carnally minded people because of this condition. Because they are living in the realm of spiritual death. It also ought to be noted here that the Holy Spirit is aggressive in his desire for people. You probably, I know many of you have witnessed to people that didn't respond, and there's a tremendous disappointment to you, and it should be. But more personalities worked with that person than you. And I want to show you how the Holy Spirit works upon people. James said it this way. Do you think that the Scripture saith in vain, the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? Now, let me read it to you some other versions. Do you think that the Scripture says in vain, the Spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously? Here's the NIV. The Spirit he caused to live in us envies intensely. Basic Bible English. The Spirit which God put into our hearts has a strong desire for us. God's Word Bible. The Spirit that lives in us wants us to be his own.
Yeah.
The Amplified Bible says, the Spirit whom he has caused to dwell in us yearns over us, and he yearns for the Spirit to be welcome with a jealous love. See? That's an aspect of spiritual life that is scarcely known. I don't know many people that even know that's in the Bible, but it is. It's quite possible, perhaps you've experienced this. You've had this nagging persuasion that you should be doing this or that that is righteous, and it's... That's the Holy Spirit yearning for you.
Amen.
That's what that is.
Yes.
He's jealous.
Mm-hmm.
When people take what God's given them, they give it to the world, it makes the Spirit jealous.
Yeah. Amen.
He yearns over the people.
Mm-hmm.
And those people you tried to influence and they didn't yield, you weren't the only one working on them.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So you can quench that Spirit. Oh, what a... Here's a spirit yearning jealously, yearning over the person. And the person, they throw water on it. They quench the Spirit. They grieve the Spirit. Oh, they don't know what they've done.
Yeah, that's right.
So God has told you that the Spirit yearns jealously over you, so now you must respond accordingly. You've got to be able to interpret these thoughts you have that have to do with you drawing closer, being more holy, being more consistent, however. But you have these, that's the Spirit yearning over you. All right, the Spirit is on Simeon and brings, leads him to the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the law. Now again, and draw attention to the devotion of Joseph and Mary. They were, we know from the offering they gave, they were poor. Mm-hmm. They're away from home. Mm-hmm. And it's an inconvenient time. But they still. They knew it says, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. That's mine. But he said.
Right.
Now, you know, in my own family, parents, I was the firstborn. And my parents did this. They gave me to God. And the effect of that on my life, I'm just beginning to kind of see. The thing I wanted you to see here is the devotion of this couple.
Yeah.
Gee, obedience can't be perfunctory or just go through the thing, a routine. Mm-hmm. Not at all. They had to count the days. They had to know when to do it. They did it at the right time. All of this confirms to us what God said. He said, all souls are mine. I got a right to tell you what to do and when to do and how to do and whatever. All souls are mine. Mm-hmm. And so if he said, give the child to me, you give the child to him. That's the way it is. So they believe that. Well, let's look at it another way. Scripture says the children of the Lord are the heritage of the children are the heritage of the Lord. What does that mean? The children belong to God. He gave them to you to raise them, uh-huh, to know and love him.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You don't want to be unfaithful to that.
Yes, amen. That's right.
He didn't say, I gave them to you to give to somebody else. You do it.
Mm-hmm.
They did it.
Amen.
You can do it. Mm-hmm. They offered their turtle doves to the Lord. Now, see, we are living in a time when there's a younger generation, and I don't say it's out of spite, because we have some people in the younger generation that are godly and commendable people. But as a whole, we're living in a time when the younger generation is abysmally ignorant of God.
Yeah.
It's like unparalleled. Why? The parents.
Yeah.
They didn't do what God told them to do.
Mm-hmm.
Raised them in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. See, it told them what to do.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't do it. And the church conveniently supplied youth ministers and things like this to. But they were faithful.
Yeah.
I thank God for them.
Amen.
So Simeon, he sees a young babe, and he took him up. You've got like the bookends of humanity, an infant and an aged man. See, that is like the whole race. There it is right there. Simeon took the infant in his arms, but he didn't see this as an infant. He's gonna talk, but he's not gonna talk about him as an infant.
Yeah.
He's just a little over 1 month old, but see, his mind's way.
Yeah.
If you know who this infant is, you can talk. Right, about what's coming.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to present the effort to the Lord. First, he says, I'm ready to die now.
Mm-hmm.
Let your servant depart in peace.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know when God made this promise to Simeon, but sometime in the past he made this promise. You're not going to die till you've seen the Lord's Christ. This is the first time Simeon's seen this baby.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Nothing in Scripture says that Mary and Joseph told him who it was.
Uh-huh. Yeah, right.
But the God that made the promise,
mm-hmm,
oh, this is the child.
Amen.
This is the one. He's come by the Spirit to the temple. God revealed this to him. Mm-hmm. Having seen the Lord's Christ, Simeon's ready now to leave the world. In peace. Now let thy servant depart. In peace. Mm-hmm. All this is according to what God had said. Simeon had rested his entire life on that word that God gave him.
Amen.
Mine eyes have seen thy salvation. Yeah, look. This is thy salvation. Several verses did a really bad job in handling this text. First note that he said it was according to God's word, that this was all according to God's word. Some of the verses read this way, I've seen your Yeshua. That's Hebrew for Jesus, but Yeshua's not, Jesus isn't in there. They thought, well, people aren't going to know what that means, so we'll tell them what it means. Well, that's what it means. Here's another one. The Murdoch said, mine eyes have seen thy mercy. Tyndale, he had it. Mine eyes have seen the Savior sent from you. He saw it. Another, the Apostolic Bible says, I've seen your deliverance. The Contemporary English Bible says, I've seen what you've done to save your people. The English Revised Version said, you will save your people. And the Jubilee Bible says, thy saving health. I don't know. I wish some of these word merchants, I wish they just say what was said. Instead of trying to make it so plain and simple by their definition. Mm-hmm. The word salvation can have the meaning of way of salvation. I understand that. Mm-hmm. But that's not what he's saying here. Mm-hmm. Salvation is wrapped up in a person. If you want to boil salvation down to its essence, it's Christ.
Amen.
That's what it is.
Amen.
It's the incarnate word. It's the word wrapped up in a body.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it goes without saying that many people saw Jesus in the flesh, but they didn't know who he really was. All the promises concerning salvation and the one who would begin and finish it are wrapped up in the babe Simeon's holding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But all those promises weren't this clear.
Mm-hmm.
The Spirit revealed this to him.
Mm-hmm.
See, some people thought that what he meant was he's going to deliver us from the Roman Empire. That's what a lot of people thought.
Mm-hmm.
But that isn't. God's salvation isn't deliverance from the Roman Empire.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yes, once God's salvation was deliverance from Egypt. I understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But now that Jesus has come, we stepped up. We're up higher now than that.
Yeah, amen.
Mm-hmm. Simeon saw. He said, notice what he saw.
Mm-hmm.
A light to lighten the Gentiles. Whoa.
Yeah.
Now, you know that, and you read back, but see, it wasn't that clear. But it is now to him.
Yeah.
The prophets had told you about this, but it was sort of veiled when they told you.
Mm-hmm.
It took many of the Jews a considerable time to realize the fullness of this promise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
More than 10 years after Pentecost, they had to have a major occurrence at the house of Cornelius and a major gathering and report to conclude the Gentiles were accepted. See, it wasn't that easy. And these were not rebel people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This wasn't that apparent.
Mm-hmm.
We got people today that can't conceive of God saving anybody but someone who's in the Christian church.
Yeah.
Or there's someone who's a Baptist.
Yeah.
Amen.
These kind of people exist. They're here.
Uh-huh.
It's the same kind we're there.
Yeah.
Same kind of people. Simeon saw it.
Mm-hmm.
So he's a light to lighten the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the glory of thy people Israel.
Yeah.
So what is the glory of God's people Israel? Well, for some people, it was the nation itself. That was just the nation itself was the glory. For other people, Abraham, we be Abraham's seed. That was the glory. Some people, Moses, we're Moses' disciples. That was the glory, see? For some people, the law, that was the glory. And some thought the Sabbath day was the glory, see? And some thought the temple was the glory. But the real glory of God's people, Israel, is Christ.
Amen.
Who are Israelites, he lists all of the advantages they had, and then he concludes that Romans 9, 4 through 5, by saying, Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever.
Yeah.
Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, I think Luke, what Luke is doing here is similar to what Matthew did, but the Matthew, he has that repeated phrase, thus was fulfilled.
Yeah.
So when he records Jesus' birth, he specifically points and quotes Old Testament scriptures and says, thus was fulfilled. Luke is doing the same thing, but he's doing it with these people.
That's right.
Simeon
and
Anna, this, what he's pointing to here is these are like personifications of God's people, the true Israelites, who had been expecting and waiting for this person to come.
Amen.
So what Luke is showing us, see, God is fulfilling all of the promises that he had made to Israel about this king that was going to come, this Christ who was going to come and save Israel and then reign over the house of David. See, Simeon and Anna, they recognize it, but they're like personifications. There have been lots of other people that were dead at this point who wanted to see this.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Peter
right.
said the prophets, they when they prophesied, they looked into this intently. They tried to figure this thing out, but it was hidden from them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You think about all the godly people who lived by faith back there under the law, under the old covenant. Who look? Jesus said, Abraham saw my day and rejoiced. They knew that something was coming, but it wasn't clear to them. And here, so Simeon and Anna, they're like personifications of Old Testament saints.
Yes, amen.
Who were looking for Jesus. These are true Israelites.
Amen. Indeed.
Mm-hmm.
I gather that this happened, this opening happened at this time when they saw the Lord's Christ, and they knew this is the one. They knew what to associate his coming with. That's good to think about, I'll tell you. Now, he's called in Genesis 49:24 the Stone of Israel. This text says the Consolation of Israel. John 1:49 says the King of Israel. Matthew 2:2 and 27:11 says the King of the Jews. And see, he's the glory.
Yeah.
He's the glory of Israel.
Mm-hmm. That's why we don't, when we think of Israel, our hearts go out to them. But more of our heart goes out to the Christ of Israel, the King of Israel, who will reconcile them. The Savior, he's the glory. Jesus himself said, I'm not sent, but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's the glory of Israel, see. Who else had that privilege?
That's
the glory of Israel. Peter affirmed, unto you first. God, having raised up his son, Jesus sent him to bless you. See, and turn away every one of you from your iniquities. Paul wrote, Jesus Christ has become a servant to the circumcision for the truth of God, to confirm the promises given to the Father. See, he was the glory. Mm-hmm. He both is the ultimate product of Israel, the ultimate blesser of Israel, the ultimate reason for Israel. He's the glory of the house of Israel. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. See? He's the Consolation of Israel. He's David. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I'm glad that Simeon said it this way. From man's perspective, it could have been said, probably would have been said differently.
Mm-hmm.
Would have been said something like, he's going to be the salvation.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Or he's going to be King of the Jews someday. But when the angels, you know, they said he's born King of the Jews.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And Simeon said, I've seen thy salvation, not what will become,
amen.
But what is.
Amen.
And that's like a stretch for us to to get a hold of that, that this, that it could be this in this state, in this condition, at this place. But really, in the work of the Lord, there really aren't contingencies.
Uh-huh.
It can look like it from our perspective, because we live in time and we're strapped with all of these disadvantages. But when he was born, he was salvaged.
Amen.
Amen.
See, apparently we can say, this is he who is coming again.
Yes, amen. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, I like what you said, that he is the whole reason that Israel existed.
That's right.
It was to produce this Savior.
Yeah, that's good. Some people talk about Israel like this was a blunder.
Uh-huh, yeah.
It wasn't a blunder.
Amen.
He's called David, the glory of Israel, the king of Israel, the root and offspring of David, the root of Jesse, the ruler of Israel, the seed of David, shepherd and stone of Israel, son of David, son of Abraham, seed of Abraham. See, that's the glory.
Yes.
That's the glory of Israel.
Yeah.
Nothing more is required to be said.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Jesus is it, the sum total. He is. Well, upon hearing this, Joseph and his mother marveled. Well, they saw how great it was. There's people that have heard this, these same words, but they haven't seen their magnitude. See? They marveled. The shepherds had reported to them that they'd heard that this is the Savior, was the glad tidings, the great joy, which will be to all people. And they both marveled at that, too. That was... They hadn't heard that before. He said he heard a heavenly host saying, glory to God in the highest on earth, peace to will toward men. Now they hear Simeon say that he's the salvation of God prepared before the face of all people, light to lighten the Gentiles, glory of God's people. And they marveled.
Yeah.
Wondered at. I made a feeble attempt to try and... project what I see in this, but man's made up of heart, soul, mind, and spirit, and it's in the order of priority. Strength, that be your natural aptitude. And what you can do as a man that animals can't do. Your mind, your understanding is in there. Your soul, that's your rationale, that's the way you use your understanding. And your heart, that's your person, so when it's in your heart, it's part of you. So ultimately, the things of God, that God has prepared for them that love him, to be understood, they must be heard, and the person must be regenerated, and at first, it's got to get down with their strength. They've got to take hold of it and refuse to leave it, see? You've got to take hold of it just in their strength. Maybe you call it inquisitive or whatever you want to call it. They see, this is something I need to pay attention to. That's strength. They had that. But the mind, it was bigger than the bag. Your strength couldn't hold it. In fact, your mind can't really hold it all either. And marveling, that's the result of something of it is not seen. We were told we've received not the spirit that is of the world. We've received the spirit that's from God, that we might know the things freely given to us, that we might know this heart, the whole heart, soul, mind, strength. You got to. There are some people that are living, they're Christian people, they say, but they're living at the strength level. They study, and they have academic understanding and this sort of thing, but they don't have spiritual understanding. That's a notch up. They don't have that. And some they can't. They know what it says. They believe what it says, but they can't work with it. They can't think with it. They can't draw conclusions or inferences or implications. They can't work with it. Joseph and Mary was it somewhere in that stage. They weren't doubting. It wasn't the marveling of doubt. It was a marvel. This is bigger than I thought. If you're in Christ, you've learned by now that when it comes to comprehending the things of God and comprehending what's going on around about you, you'll find out your natural capacities are pretty weak.
Yeah, that's right.
I said, you'll find out. The things of God, particularly as they're in regard to salvation, deal with realities that are outside the boundary of natural human aptitude and experience. They're outside. That's why the marvel is. That's what causes the marvel. This is, whoa, this is outside what I'm accustomed to. So God, first of all, works with you to make you equal to that revelation. Some people, they're faced with this. Now, they see it, they can't understand it, so they forget it. And they leave it. But that, when you can't see something from God, that should compel you to press in, to take the kingdom by violence. Mm-hmm. Press in there. Then God will show it to you. To this point in Luke's gospel, what's been made known is actually very limited. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna list here some things that weren't known at that time, mm-hmm. that you gotta know now. What was involved in the word becoming flesh? no idea. Mm-hmm. No one else would have had the idea. Paul didn't expound it to us. What Jesus was coming primarily to do was the will of God, not answer Israel's problems. This isn't how the Jews thought. Regeneration, justification, faith that justifies, gift of the Holy Spirit, sanctification, the joining of Jew and Gentile in one body, reigning with Christ, receiving spiritual gifts, names written in heaven, the new covenant. Well, I won't read them all, but see, these are things that you must know.
Yeah, that's right.
That they couldn't know.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Yeah. And what did Simeon said? What exactly did he say that caused them to marvel? He said his eyes had seen God's salvation. He said the salvation was prepared before the face of all people. Jesus was a light to lighten the Gentiles, and Jesus was the glory of God's people, Israel. Mm-hmm. They marveled.
Yeah.
See? Mm-hmm. So what does that tell you? That tells me salvation is really a lot bigger than people think.
Yeah. Amen.
Even at its rudimentary level, it is profound. Even at the rudimentary level.
Yeah.
That's why they marveled. Because it wasn't because they were so small, it's because the truth was so big. Mm-hmm. That was the difference. Now I ask you, that those things that he revealed, how does that compare with what you personally know about Jesus? If you've been in Christ and grown to any degree, like, you're light years ahead of that.
Yes.
Yet you still need that. Prior to the exaltation of Christ, the truth about Christ was in small doses and infrequent. Sometimes it'd be a long time before anything was actually said about the coming Christ. And when it was not much. Not much.
Yeah.
It's only once God illuminated some of the things the prophets said that they could even say things about. Joseph and Mary were among the most noble souls on the earth, and yet they marveled at what was said.
Yeah.
Not the marvel of unbelief. Mm-hmm. It's a marvel of greatness. Once God said this of Israel, may he not say it of any gathering of professed Christians.
Yeah.
For my people are foolish. They know me not. They are stupid children. They have no understanding. They are shrewd to do evil, but to do good they do not know. That's the New American Standard.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
God forbid that should ever be said. But I think I think God has that to say of some professing Christians. Then it says that Simeon blessed them.
Yeah.
Them being Mary and Joseph. He didn't bless the child. Why? He'd already been blessed.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, he's called God blessed forever.
Yeah, amen.
Romans 9:5. See, he'd already been blessed. He didn't have to be blessed by Simeon at all, but he blessed them. I gather that was in order they might raise this child up.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've experienced this, but I've never been satisfied of the academic definitions of bless. They all seem to, it's not what I want anyway. So I give them where what they are. The English word bless actually seems pretty satisfactory, to invoke divine care. All right, that's pretty good. So I see what Simeon was doing was preparing Mary and Joseph for the what lay ahead of them.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They had to raise this child to manhood for the work God had given them to do. Then Simeon, he turns to his mother, not to Joseph now, because Joseph wasn't his father. Turns to Mary, got a word to say to her. She's a vessel God used to bring his son into the world. Blessed among women, boy, I guess so.
Yeah.
The woman who brought his son into the world. I mean, think about it. What?
Yeah.
The magnitude of it. As I said, the word bless, that's what I feel is talking about, preparing him. Mm-hmm. He said to his, he said to Mary, his mother. He specified his mother. In the scripture, 19 times Mary is called his mother. Mm-hmm. 19 times. And she's called the mother of Jesus 3 times. See, so that's an important point.
Yeah.
He says, now Mary, this child is set. Set, not like set in concrete. Set as in predestined, appointed, destinated. See that? This child is set. Appointed to. Now for some, this was a, translators, this appeared to be too strong. So here's how, here's basic Bible English says, he will be. See, this wasn't like a prophecy. This was an announcement.
Yeah, amen. Yes.
The Holman Bible says he will cause. The Good God's Word Bible says this is the reason. Living Bible says shall be. See, that's different than destined or set or determined. Jesus was appointed to cause the results he's going to mention. And some of them, he's going to cause some to fall. It's listed first, incidentally. You might note that it's the first. He's set. He's been sent to do this. These people wouldn't fall if Jesus didn't come. He's set for the fall of some. Let's see how this stacks up to Scripture. Psalmist said, the stone which the builders refused has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord is doing his marvelous in our eyes. Isaiah said, he shall be for a sanctuary, but for a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel. Peter taught, unto you therefore which believe he is precious, but unto them be which is obedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. See, he was appointed. Jesus was appointed. When this happens, it's not your fault.
Yeah, that's right.
If you delivered the message, it's not because you didn't say it good enough.
That's right. Amen.
Or nice enough or kind enough. This is something God has charge of. This is one of Christ's commissions.
Yes, amen.
There's some people that are going to fall. You're going to make them. That's why you're coming into the world, son, to cause their fall.
Yeah.
That's what the text says.
Amen.
Yes.
Again, Jesus said, I am come to set a man at variance against his father and a daughter against her mother and so forth. That's what I've come for. So when this happens, you can go in the bedroom and cry. Or you can say, well, this is what Jesus came to do. Thank God he didn't have me do it. Huh? Thank the Lord he didn't charge us with doing this.
Amen.
This is something he does. So if there's variance, make sure he caused it. Jesus said, "For judgment I am come into the world. I am come to send fire on earth, and what will it if it be kindled? But I have a baptism to be baptized with. Suppose ye I am coming to give peace on earth? Nay, but rather division." See, she's telling you. This child is set for the fall. Now, we acknowledge this isn't the primary reason. This is not the primary reason that Jesus came. But it is part of the reason. And he's also going to cause some people to rise from the dead. And he said he's going to be for a sign spoken against. This is why I'm sending him. See, some folk would never know that so-and-so was against God if Jesus hadn't come.
That's right. Yep.
They'd have thought some of these people were really sincere believers. Uh-huh. But when Jesus came, he exposed me. It's a sign spoken against. Mm-hmm. Jesus drew out of people. Maybe you'll remember some of the things they said about Jesus. They called him that deceiver. Matthew 27:63. "Thou art a Samaritan and hast a devil." John 8:48. "Thou blasphemest." John 10:36. "He is beside himself." Mark 3:21. "He cannot save others." Himself he saved others. Himself he cannot save. Mark 15:30. "This man is a gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners." Matthew 11:19. "Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Who makest thou thyself?" Mm-hmm. We know this man's a sinner. John 9:24. See, that's what people spoke against. They spoke against Christ. Jesus himself is the ultimate sign.
Yeah.
"And Mary, a sword will pierce through your own soul." May would not be impervious to the words spoken against her son, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Nor would she be indifferent when he was finally crucified. Although no gospel writer goes into the effect it had on Mary, but it did have effect. We know it because of what Simeon said, soul. She apparently was the kind of woman that when her heart was broken, she closed her mouth. It's a good thing to do.
Yeah.
Good thing to do. All of this made known to her at the beginning of Jesus' life. Before they got back to home, all this is made known. Why is this going to happen? That the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed.
Yeah.
Revealed to who? God knew what they were. Revealed to you.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we lift up Christ, talk about Jesus.
Yeah.
It does two things. Some people fall, some people rise.
Yeah. Amen.
In other words, say to the end that the thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. What a way to reveal hearts. Not by a statement, but by a person whose nature is contrary to theirs. Now, whether men utter words or not, everyone who fails to believe on Christ then live for him, they've spoken against him. See? He's a sign. Someone doesn't listen to him, they don't live for him, they don't embrace him, they're speaking, their life is speaking against him.
Mm-hmm.
Their actions, they've suggested he's unworthy of commitment.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they've said.
That's right.
He's misrepresented who he is. That's what they say. They display their hatred for him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, while all this is going on, there's another person we're introduced to. There was one... Not two or three. There was one.
Yeah.
Had one man, one woman.
Mm-hmm.
Anna, a prophetess, daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. Now, this entire event's being managed from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
To the right people showing up at the right time. These people know the right people to pass the word along. See, the shepherds, they knew who to tell it to.
Yeah.
And now... Anna, she's going to know who to tell it to. Anna was a prophetess in the temple.
Yeah.
Boy, well, that'd stir up trouble in a lot of places today. woman prophet could trace her lineage back to Asher, who was the 11th son of Jacob, born through Zilpah. She named him Asher. Asher means happiness. Hundreds of years later, here surfaces this woman who can trace her lineage back to Asher in Genesis, the book of Genesis. Does anyone know of anybody that kept a family tree that precise? I mean, you get back beyond the 1800s, you're doing a lot of fishing, but see, these were different kind of people.
That's right.
These were different kind of people. Now, it says of her that she was of great age. And that meant she was really old, we would say. Advanced years, be a polite way to say it. Says she was a great age and had lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity. That's an interesting way to define when you were married. Now, some of the other versions say, let me read these versions to you. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. She was very old and after 7 years of married life. Having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin. Well, they got it right. And she was very old. Her husband died when they had been married only 7 years. So I took the time to look up the word, and sure enough, it is the word virginity. That's the word. And it does mean what it means now. Never married, never has had intimacy with a man. I don't know why these verses like this didn't say that.
Right, yeah.
But they didn't. Some people think it's inconsequential. No, it was mentioned because it wasn't inconsequential. She was a widow about 84 years. All right, now we get off on the left field here. Here's some of the versions. The NIV says she was 84. She was a widow until she was 84. Footnote, widow for 84 years. Basic Bible English says she had been a widow for 84 years. She was now an 84-year-old widow. Well, that's a big... She had been a widow even for 84 years, English Revised. She was a widow about 84 years. She had been a widow for 84 years. She was a widow about 84 years. She had lived as a widow since then for 84 years. She had been a widow for 84 years, as a widow for 84 years. So you can see a slight difference there. Is this, was she 84 years old? Or was she widowed for 84 years? So a lot of the versions say, all right, let's say that what it means is she was 84 years old, right? Now, we know that she was married for 7 years. So if we take 7 away from 84, that would mean she got married when she was 77, right? And I personally think it's an insult to someone's intelligence to suggest such a thing. She was, at the youngest age, they tell us that they would marry, would be 14, that would be the youngest. If that was the case, she would be 105 in this text. So she's at least 105 and up. And when it says of great age, I can't imagine that being 84. That's not even great age today.
That's right.
She departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. Just like that's what the certain Levites. It's 24.
Yeah.
She lived there, in other words. An extraordinary woman. I mean, you have to admit.
Yeah.
But that's the kind of person now that the father wants associated with the birth of his son. That kind of woman. Notice again the spiritual caliber of the people. there's still, the people that come to Jesus are still the, this caliber people. It's just that it's not so apparent sometimes, but that's still the kind of people that come to Christ. And she coming in that instant, just, I guess she just kind of come in while this was being said. Look at the timing. She was in the temple all the time. But at this particular time, she comes in when this is going on. And it says, and likewise she gave thanks. Who she hears it, she gave thanks too. Join in the small group with insight, gratefulness. And she spake of the occasion. Is that what it says?
No.
She spake of him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's the same thing with the shepherds. Remember, they didn't say, and this is what we experienced. We heard angels sing. They said they spake of him, what the angels said about him. She spake of him. Anna was not speaking about Simeon or Joseph or Mary, but about the child. Who else but this child, who was the Word made manifest in the flesh, or God manifest in the flesh, who else could be the catalyst of this great kingdom of salvation that was being established, huh? Well, to see it when he was a man, all right, that'd be a relative, that'd be easy, but when it's a babe. He's a babe, because he probably looked like any other baby. Well, not maybe he had some peculiar good looks about him, but that's when she saw it. Simeon saw it. Anna saw it.
That's right.
It's here. Time is here. And it says she went and told all. It doesn't say she went. Excuse me. It says she told. She spake of him to all them. I used to think she went out in Jerusalem and, no, it tells you she never left the temple.
That's
it tells
right,
you.
Yeah.
So these are people coming in the temple. And I get the picture that coming in there, she's a prophetess. She'd made certain close associations with certain people that came to the temple regularly. Here they come, and she's got this news. That's what Joel prophesied when he said, it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered, for in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance. And she said, this is it.
Yeah.
Said to this nucleus of believers. Reported in the temple. There were people that she, like the money changers, she didn't go out, are there any money changers there? She didn't,
yeah.
she didn't tell it to them. She told the people that were looking.
Yeah, amen.
God has stirred them up, see? So we talked about there Wednesday. God had found these people, stirred them up, and they're waiting for redemption. Now here comes the validation.
Amen. Yeah.
They've been longing, here comes the validation. It's here. Then it says they, so matter of fact, they returned to Galilee. Well, they sure didn't return like they went from Galilee.
Right.
When they went from Galilee, it was just Joseph and Mary and expecting. They come back, Joseph and Mary and the Christ child, and a bunch of reports and a lot of things to think about.
Yeah. Amen.
Said that they did this after they'd performed all the things according to the law of their, notice, of the Lord. Then they returned. So they weren't done yet. After Anna came in, they weren't done yet. They had to apparently offer the offerings yet, so they finished up. Them people in the joy of the moment, they run off and forget, you know. They didn't forget to fulfill the law.
Amen.
Now this is all done before sin was taken away, before there was a new creation. Before there was a new and living way that opened up to heaven. Before principalities and powers had been destroyed. So you can only imagine now what can be done now.
Yes, amen.
And it's of great value to report what you've seen.
Amen.
Right?
Yes.
Amen.
The shepherds reported what they saw.
Yes.
Now we see the Anna reported what she saw. Yes, Brother Jason.
The Simeon and Anna, I think that they're, the fact that they were both elderly, I think both of these are, they're like personifications of the old covenant.
That's right, good.
And their old age, I think, might point, I don't want to over-spiritualize the scripture.
I know what you're saying.
But I think that this is like the old covenant is waxing old, like it says in Hebrews. It waxed old, it's obsolete. This is, you've got this juxtaposition of these old folks and this baby.
That's right.
So it's like the end of this old order.
Amen. Mm-hmm. You're right.
And it's the beginning, the dawning of this new age, the
Amen.
Kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
The kingdom was starting here in this baby.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
This is where it was starting. It's the beginning. Mm-hmm. See, it's like what we call passing the baton.
That's mm-hmm. right.
It's like the what was old is now giving way to what is new. But you'll notice that Luke makes a point, though, that what Jesus... He didn't come in opposition to the law and
That's
the prophets.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Because Mary and Joseph, they did everything.
They did everything.
According to the law and the prophets. Paul says he was born, Galatians 4:4, he was born under the
under
law.
Under the law.
Mm-hmm.
You could not point to Jesus and say that he had ever, ever broken
That's
the law
right.
of Moses.
Amen.
Even when he was an infant,
Amen.
His parents obeyed the law of Moses. Mm-hmm. So the gospel of the new covenant is not out of left field. It's not God changing plans.
No.
It's God fulfilling.
Amen.
And now this thing that had been promised way back to Abraham, or even further back in the Garden of Eden, the seed of the woman bruised the serpent's head.
Mm-hmm.
Now this was coming to pass.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a perfect transition.
Amen.
A perfect transition that was orchestrated by God Himself.
Amen.
As we see in these two elderly saints.
Yeah, amen.
Brother Jason shared that with me. I'm glad you, before, privately, so I'm glad you brought that up because they were like the bookends of a period of time. The babe at the front, or the babe at the back, and these two aged, seasoned law keepers.
Amen.
I find great delight in some of these people that I just mentioned very, very little.
Yeah.
But the key people like this, their name is mentioned, it just kind of is in your mind, pinned in your mind.
Yeah.
I think what's noted most significantly about these two, Simeon and Anna, is that they were believers.
Mm-hmm.
They were believers.
Oh, amen.
Yeah.
I mean, they were law keepers, but they were believers.
Well, they were believing.
They stood head and shoulders
amen.
Above most.
Yeah.
Law-keeping people.
Law doesn't produce
Jerusalem
hope.
And Israel,
mm-hmm.
yes.
Right, and they were living by hope.
That's right.
That's absolutely
yeah.
right.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Both were illuminated. Both had understanding and perception.
The first time they heard, see, this is not so. The person
mm-hmm.
is enslaved to law.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we could say you can live ahead of your time.
Yes.
David did. See, David lived ahead of his time.
Uh-huh. Yep.
You can live ahead of your time.
Amen.
You have to have a lot of grace to do it, but it's
mm-hmm.
possible.
Amen.
Yes.
I appreciate you bringing out that Simeon blessed Joseph and Mary.
Yeah.
So, Lord, this is the Lord's way to prepare His people
right.
for
uh-huh.
upcoming trials that
Very good.
That will seek to shake their foundation, but
Amen.
When you hearken back to those things that the Lord has told you through His people, then you're able to endure hardness as a good soldier.
Well, you know, when Jesus was here in the Gospels and He was preaching, and someone wouldn't believe, they would say things like He hardened their heart or they didn't believe, but it doesn't say that. When Joseph and Mary marveled, it doesn't say that. And this
yeah.
they did because it See, that was
right,
a
yeah.
different. It was a different kind of thing. They
That's
were
right.
they were actually believers,
Amen.
But they hadn't imagined this thing as large as it is. Which I know what that's like. I have experienced this myself. I had no idea when I was young of the immensity of salvation and the scope of it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure that they didn't understand this, but It said several times of Mary that she hid those things
that's
in her heart.
Right. That's
it's
a
like
conduit.
she had perception that these are big things and I'm going to hang on,
that's right.
hang on to these, mm-hmm. so that there was going to be a time when those it would dawn on her.
You know, in Acts, she's brought up a number of times
that's
whenever
right.
they had those gatherings, Mary.
That's right.
So this all dawned on her.
Yeah, amen.
But yeah, she was faithful. She pondered them. A couple of times it said that. I'm going to say it again when next text we go through. Mm-hmm. Jesus said something that was like a rebuke. Mm-hmm. And she hid that in her heart.
Yeah.
Amen. I was thinking about this when you was talking about the glory of God and how like Christ was the glory of the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
And he's our glory too. And so I was just thinking about different groups that they don't really glory in Christ.
Well, I know.
They glory in whatever position they have.
Yeah.
So unless wherever you're at, wherever you're meeting, unless they're centered in Christ, then there's nothing that can really happen there. You can't
right.
really grow in Christ. You can't grow in the Lord because that causes an obstruction.
That's right.
Because then
that's
you're
right.
just focused on that thing, and so Satan uses that to sidetrack all the people.
That's right. Mm. Yeah, you're right. He wasn't only the glory of his what he says he's the head of the body. That's saying the same thing, but it's showing you more of the details. That it's more than just the great shining one. He's integrated. The greatness of the church is found in Christ's association with them.
You see these people, like this woman I told Tony the other day, she asked me, do you believe in the rapture, you know? But she didn't talk about Christ. That was her thing.
Uh-huh.
So it's just like, this is what they think about, you know? They don't center on Christ. They're like sidetracked.
Yeah.
Yep.
Off the way.
Well, you can help direct them. When I was preaching, I've been convicted of election and predestination. I was preaching it, and a young man asked me, said, do you believe in predestination, Brother Given? I said, absolutely not.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe in God.
Yeah.
So that... But sometimes some people are just saying something because that's what they've been taught to say, you know? Sometimes you can introduce a question that at least they'll ponder it in their heart,
that's
maybe.
Right. Yeah. Amen.
Maybe you could ask, did you marvel at that?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it was
yes.
good to see that
God provided two witnesses, here in the temple, and then later God's going to provide two witnesses later. John the Baptist is going to say he's the Son of God, and Peter's going to say, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. So he gives another two witnesses.
That's
there.
Right.
Amen.
He gave two witnesses to the shepherds.
Yes, that's right.
The angel of the Lord and the heavenly host.
Yeah.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for Simeon and for Anna, for this record. And we pray, Father, that we would learn to have instant kind of responses like they gave, be able to instantly recognize what you're doing, what you're showing us. Again, we thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen.